And this is what they refer to as the classic confrontation of two tremendously skilled scientific wrestlers, Brad Rangins out of Appleton, Minnesota, and the British Empire heavyweight champion, Billy Robinson from Manchester, England. Two tremendously skilled wrestlers, both weighing about the same. Rangins at 241, Robinson at 250. Robinson, as we say, the British Empire heavyweight champion, having won back that title from Albert Wells of England not that long ago. Robinson, the veteran. Brad Rangins, the young man on his way to the top, getting better each and every time out. A test of strength here between these two, both with tremendous finishing holds. Rangins, with his side body souffle, will put the lights out for anybody. Billy Robinson will work a chin lock and reverse it. Wow, what an elbow smash there. Holy cow. Robinson right up over the top rope, and well, you see him as he's trying to get the cobwebs clear. What we were saying was Robinson will work a rear chin lock around into the neck breaker, and then he also has a very, very quick backbreaker hold, which can end a match just that quickly. This is 1-4 and 20 minutes. Jim Mitchell is the third man in. A full house looking on at the Civic Center in St. Paul, Minnesota. There's a tremendous shoulder block by Brad Rangins. And a headlock and a takedown by Rangins. Jim Mitchell checking to make sure that both shoulders are on that mat before he starts a count. Billy Robinson has wrestled all over the world and is certainly one of the finest. There's a hold in this professional wrestling world that he doesn't know. Well, I don't know what it might be. He can work so very, very quickly. Move and counter move. Interesting to see what he's gonna do to get out of this headlock, which Brad Rangins has on him. He twists and turns. Is he gonna get to a headstand here? He does. Rangins with a tremendous grip on him. Can he twist out? He does. But Rangins just as quickly back into it. Here you have Rangins in trouble. Brad Rangins again taking a two count as Robinson turns him over on his back. But all the time, Brad Rangins with the headlock on the man from Manchester. Rangins continuing that punishing headlock. That's what cauliflower ears are made out of. Ask the former heavyweight champion of the world, Vern Gagne, about that. What a fantastic career that man had, and what a tremendous contribution he made to the grandest sport of them all, professional wrestling. Look at this by Robinson. Trying to kick his way out. Somehow or another, jar Rangins enough so he can slip out of the hold. So far, Bradley holding on and holding tough.
10 minutes go of the match. 10 minutes remaining.
It is a 20-minute match. Rangins, of course, wants a shot again at heavyweight champion Nick Bockwinkel. Head scissors. After Robinson had broken the hold, and Rangins finds another way to tie his man up. And again, the pressure on Billy Robinson. Those ears have got to be getting very, very sore about now. Robinson himself would like, of course, another crack at that heavyweight championship of the world. He is, as we have said before, the British Empire heavyweight champion. Let's see what he's got in store here for Brad Rangins. He tries to separate those feet. Some special pressure here. If anybody can do it or knows a way to do it, Billy Robinson does. You can see Rangins maybe feeling the hold slipping away from him. Putting on maximum pressure as much as he can. And now suddenly the advantage, well, for a moment it looked like it was Robinson. Robinson in a predicament, but he works his way out. As we said before, it's the classic confrontation. Watch this. He is trying to work that chin lock into the neck breaker. Down he came. Rangins in trouble on a cover and a two count, but no more. Again, the chin lock. Rangins and Robinson, Robinson and Rangins. And right now, Billy Robinson is in control, and that is close to being a sleeper hold, as close as you can get, but apparently not it. Referee Jim Mitchell checks to make sure it's not a choke. Robinson just about twisting the neck off the shoulders of Brad Rangins at this point. Apparently, the legs of Brad Rangins were outside the lower rope strand, and Jim Mitchell called Robinson to break the hold, and Billy, being the kind of wrestler that he is, does exactly that, and the fans appreciate it. There's a boot to the midsection. Watch this again. Again, the neck breaker. Down he comes. And again, Rangins is stunned. And again, Robinson goes quickly to work, putting pressure underneath the chin and forcing the head back. But again, Rangins is in the ropes, and again, Robinson will have to break the hold. Break it he does. Rangins trying to shake out the webs or what have you. There's a hip lock takedown by the British Empire heavyweight champion. And again, he is going to work on the head and the neck of Brad Rangins. We can't see it all that clearly right now. As you see what we see, Jim Mitchell checking with Rangins to see if he has had enough, and Bradley saying no. Now he turns around, and we're into a front face lock here with Robinson in control. One fall, 20 minute time limit. Brad Rangins working a fireman's carry, and over goes Robinson. Robinson quickly back on the attack, but he takes a right into the pit of the stomach, buried almost all the way to the elbow. Both these men shaken here in the past seconds. Forearm smash by Robinson, right hand by Rangins. Forearm smash, Rangins, and down goes Robinson. But quickly he is underneath that lower rope strand. And as quickly as he is told to do so, Rangins breaks the hold. Rangins took a lot of punishment over a period of 4 or 5 minutes there. And his own way, welcoming the opportunity to get things clear. Robinson is getting a bit of extra time. He has a 10 count out there. But every time, Rangins comes over, of course, the count starts all over again. 5 minutes left. As you heard ring announcer Gene Okerlund announce, and a tremendous confrontation between two exceptionally skilled athletes here. Knuckle hookup, Greco-Roman knuckle hookup. Wow, look at this by Robinson. Trouble here for Rangins. A two count, but Rangins does just so barely struggle his way free. Rangins is still in trouble. He does somersault his way free of the precarious situation in which he found himself. And now he has the legs of Billy Robinson all tied up, and Robinson is in trouble. This has been surge and counter-surge from the very outset. And watch that by Robinson. What scientific maneuvers between these two. Two count after two count. Robinson rolls Rangins on his shoulders, and Brad boots Robinson in the forehead, stuns the British Empire champion, gives him a forearm to the lower jaw. Rangens trying to set his man up for the kill. A headbutt to the midsection. And the wind goes out very quickly in a maneuver like that. Again, the Irish whip. Robinson held onto that rope strand. As you saw, Rangens was prepared to rifle that right hand into the midsection and do further damage to the solar plexus. Front face lock by Brad Rangens. What's he trying to make it into?
Now 3 minutes remain in this match. 3 minutes to go.
You've heard the amount of time left. Rangens has not been able to use his side body souffle yet in this one. He turns it over. He's going to try the neck breaker himself on Robinson. Down they go. That's one of Robinson's favorite maneuvers. Rangens turns him over, covers him, gets two but not three. What a match between these two. Here comes... What is it going to be, the atomic drop? It is. Oh, that's got to hurt. Robinson is spined, rearranged slightly. Again, a two count, but he drapes that leg over the lower rope strand, and referee Jimmy Mitchell spots it, and they will be forced to break the hold. Rangens doesn't like it and comes down on that right leg. We're in the final 3 minutes of this match.
2 minutes remaining of the match.
In the final two, and a forearm smash here by Rangens. Robinson turns him into the corner. Will Irish whip him? No, a reversal here by Rangens. Robinson again in trouble, and a heel throw, and down goes Robinson. Again, an arm drag takedown. One more time for Rangens. Here's Bradley. The body slam. Close to three, so very, very close. Both of these men fully expanding themselves. The head cracker here. Is that what Rangens has in mind? That's what it is. And Robinson sees stars on this one. We're in the final minute. Rangens trying to set him up for a body drop and takes a forearm smash instead from Robinson, who now suddenly finds himself in control. And here's a shoulder block by Robinson as we're in the final minute. Here is the souple by Brad Rangens, a quick cover. One, two. It was so very, very close. Rangens trying to press the advantage that he has, but time is running out for him. Rangens again trying to put in the side body souple, but Robinson has backed off to the ropes and the hold must be broken.
10 seconds,
forearm smash, Robinson, right hand. Again the right hand by Rangens as the countdown goes to one, and this one is all over. What a tremendous match between Brad Rangens and Billy Robinson. It will go into the books as a draw. I don't know that either one of them have heard the bell signifying the end of this one. Jimmy Mitchell prized them apart. And this one is all over. And what a match it was. It goes as a draw. Robinson and Rangens. These two are still eyeing each other in the ring. We're wondering if some postscript may be coming about here. It officially is over. Mitchell wants them to shake hands. Neither of them really want that. Both of them wanted a decision here. But both of them also know the rules of the game and abide by them just about 100%. All right, gentlemen, tremendous match, Rangens and Robinson. Rough and tumble, Jesse the Body Ventura with a chin lock here on Steve-O. Steve Olsonowski out of Edina, Minnesota. Jesse in at 281 pounds. As he is back in the AWI, that's about 10 pounds more than when he and Adrian Adonis, for instance, were the tag team champions. Jesse the Body Ventura out of San Diego, California, has been in control of this match from the outset. A tremendous opportunity here for Steve-O. Steve Olsonowski, a win over Jesse Ventura, of course, would vault him into national prominence. Show of strength here. And Steve-O is doing a number on Jesse the Body, but then Jesse doesn't like the way things are going, and as he usually does, he grabs hold of the hair to get his man away from the advantage that his man has. And of course, he denies it, as he is doing now to referee Marty Miller. And all the while, Ventura with the rear chin lock on Steve-O, applying more and more pressure and giving more and more conversation too. Miller checks to make sure it's not a choke.
What are you looking at over there?
You can hear Jesse the Body Ventura talking to whether it's Gene Okerlund or some fan at ringside, I'm not sure. There again, a grab of the hair. However, this time, I believe Marty Miller saw it. Marty is looking over toward Gene Okerlund. You heard Ventura there. No, I didn't touch his hair. Well, apparently Marty did not see it because the hold has not been broken. And still, the chin lock on Olsonowski by Jesse the Body Ventura. And indeed, he has the body. Jesse says he has spent some time in Grenada here as of late. Steve Olsonowski trying to work his way free and clear, drives an elbow, and again, three elbows into the midsection, the solar plexus of Jesse the Body Ventura. Ventura misses an elbow, flying body slam here by Steve-O, and a count of two. Twice, very, very quickly in this match, Steve-O has caught Jesse the Body Ventura and just about been able to pin him. Just about, that is. Forearm smash off the second rope, an elbow smash to the back of the head. Another shot, this time a karate shot and thrust to the throat. Flying drop kick, and suddenly Steve-O is on the offensive, goes over a quick cover. Again, two, but no more. Steve-O picks up that 280 pounds and a body slam. And Jesse Ventura wants to go for a walk. He needs some time. He has only 10 seconds to get back in or face disqualification. Now he'll get another 10 as Steve-O did not hold his ground across the ring. Steve-O, sensing that he has the big man in trouble at the 10-minute mark of this match, and knowing it is a very, very important match to him. And, of course, Jesse the Body, if he wants to move up in the ranks, cannot afford a loss in this one. Steve Olsonowski, 238 pounds. Jesse the Body Ventura, 280. Ventura saying, watch the fist, watch the fist, watch the fist. And Marty Miller warns Steve-O. shots to the face by Jesse the Body Ventura. And again, Steve-O is stunned. And three times he takes the right foot to the head and chest area, and out he goes. Marty Miller with a warning for Ventura, who completely ignores it. Ventura driving the head of Steve-O to the apron. Steve Olsonowski in trouble. Jesse the Body Ventura back again. Forearm smash right to the throat. Steve Olsonowski certainly has his hands full here, but he has gone on the offensive a couple of times in this match and has really caught and stunned Jesse the Body Ventura. Let's see if he can do it again. Ventura bound and determined not to let him back in the ring. And of course, when he does that, of course, Olsonowski gets another 10 seconds out there to recoup and recover. Hey, Olsonowski with some thoughts of his own. He is going to wrap that leg around that post. Give it a look. Ouch! And a right hand to the head by Steve-O. He has one of the ropes from ringside now that he's wrapping around the neck of Jesse the Body Ventura. Steve-O is going to have to get himself back in the ring quickly, or he could be disqualified here. He did beat the clock. He continues his assault on Jesse the Body Ventura. Steve-O with an Irish whip and a flying drop kick that caught him flush. And Jesse the Body on Queer Street almost. Here is going to be the airplane spin. Can the Body withstand it? He gets a hold of the rope and that saves him. They go crashing to the canvas, both Ventura and Steve-O. Ventura seems to be the one that's the worst for wear. Marty Miller is counting over both of them. Steve Olsonowski on his feet, goes to the second rope. What does he have in store? He misses the elbow smash as Ventura rolled out of the way. And he took the full force of the blow himself. And now Ventura to the second rope. And a knee drop to the middle of the back of Steve-O. That certainly is a disabling type move. Here you go with the inverted body vice for Jesse Ventura. Can Olsonowski hang in there? No, he cannot. Steve-O has to submit to the inverted body vice put on by Jesse the Body Ventura. And now Ventura don't let go, but then he drops him like a sack of potatoes. Steve Olsonowski gave him all that he wanted, and right at the time that he looked like he had him, suddenly Jesse the Body turned the tables and put him in that inverted body vice, and that was all she wrote. Jesse the Body Ventura out of San Diego, California, wins a big one here over Steve Olsonowski. Ricky Martel, the oh-so-very popular young man from Quebec City, Canada, in a virtual must-win situation here against superstar Billy Graham from Paradise Valley, Arizona. The reason I say that is that Martel has designs on the heavyweight championship of the world, and to move up the ladder, he's got to beat this man who is now in front of him, the master of Taekwondo, superstar Billy Graham. Graham with a 32-pound weight advantage as they hook up in the Greco-Roman knuckle lock. A test of strength here. This Graham is an absolute magnificent specimen. What a tremendous body he has. 269 pounds. And suddenly he has worked an advantage in the knuckle lock on the young man from Quebec City, Canada. Ricky Martel turns it over. Tremendous strength for Superstar, who has wrestled all over the world. Look at that body. Look at that back. And those arms. Tremendous. Putting the pressure on Ricky Martel. Billy Graham was the WWF champion back in 1977, defeating Bruno Sammartino in a championship match. Real test of strength here between these two, and really Ricky Martel asks no quarter and gives none. Twice, a two count. But you've got to get three. Two is close, but no cigar. Martel calling on his reserve. Coming up and coming on. Oh, and he turned it around. And he turns it around again. And the pressure is on the man from Paradise Valley, who reaches for the rope strand. And you see that he got what he wanted. Not only the rope strand, but Martel had to break the hold. Kenny J is the referee in this tremendous match. 1 hour, correction, one fall, 45 minute time limit. One fall, 45 minute time limit on this. Nobody really having a clear cut advantage so far. Bear hug by Superstar Billy Graham, and you see the pain that Martel is in as Graham just picks him up and hangs onto him and applies the pressure at the same time. Graham is holding 237 pounds plus applying the tremendous pressure to the back and rib cage. Kenny J checking with Ricky Martel. But knowing Ricky, there isn't any way that he is going to submit here tonight or any time as far as that's concerned, but particularly tonight with the great amount of importance riding on this match. Graham tightening the vise. Martel trying to work his way clear as that fist cock does not throw it. But here, look, see, and he rings the bell of Billy Graham. But quickly, Billy Graham back to the bear hug again. Driving Martel to the corner, driving him in there again. Pressure on the middle of the back and also the top of the back in this maneuver. And also the shoulder doing punishment in front. Graham, the cover. Irish whip. Watch this reversal. Martel has him in a tremendous predicament here, but can get only two. Martel showing the effects of the bear hug that Billy Graham has had on him. Graham now trying to size up or set up. Taekwondo, there's a thrust to the midsection. Two elbow smashes by Graham. And a right hand to the head. Martel trying to shake off the effects of it all. backs to the corner, but again to the attack. However, a reversal here, and suddenly Graham is whipped into the turnbuckle. Martel going to work. The atomic drop that rearranges the spine. Now Martel is ready to go. Firing away, bombs away here, and a flying drop kick on Graham. Again, the whip across and the right hand to the midsection. Martel picks up that 280 pounds or 269 pounds. Slams it to the mat. Has his man in trouble, but there is the taekwondo to the throat, which Graham says, uh-oh, Graham has tossed him up and over that top rope, and this one will be all over. That is illegal. Graham will be disqualified for that maneuver, throwing Ricky Martel over the top rope.
The referee has disqualified superstar Billy Graham.
The victory to Rick Martel, but Martel won it another way. And in he comes, and he fires away, going to work on Billy Graham. He did not like the way this ended at all. Martel has come back in the ring, and suddenly Graham is out of the ring. Graham throws a chair in. Martel has it, and Graham thinks better about making his way back into that ring. And that is all for this night, as Ricky Martel stands in the ring victorious after taking that taekwondo thrust to the throat, which could well have been to the esophagus, although Billy Graham says he aims it at the trapezius muscles instead, on the side of the neck. Anyway, it's all over. Ricky Martel, your winner.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, if I may have your attention, you heard earlier my announcement, a match that has been signed for right here in the City Center for Sunday night, January the 15th. They are calling it a Texas Bunkhouse match. Bobby the Brain Heenan will be going against this gentleman, you know him, Black Jack Renza. If we can keep her down, I, along with you, very curious, just exactly, Blackjack Lanza, what is a Texas Bunkhouse match?
Texas Bunkhouse match is naturally from Texas. Now, this is a very special match. This is a match that the Cowboys initiated, unbeknownst to them, even them. This is after a hard day's work. This is a match, in my finger case, that I requested from promoter Wally Carver. This is a match because the weasel is the weasel. Now, the match is this. Anything goes. The weasel will have to come into this ring wearing boots, blue jeans, an old shirt, and a cowboy hat.
Well, he's not going to like that at all. He'll look like a rhinestone cowboy.
This match originated down in the bunkhouse in Texas. After a hard day's work, the cowboys would have a few beers. They get into a fist fight. They still do that down in Texas. They fight with their fists. The man who is getting beat up would take a liking to get out of the way and try to escape. Well, there was a ring of cowboys around a big circle. When he tried to escape, they picked him back up and threw him back in a circle.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, very interesting to say the least.
Now, enter the weasel in this ring. 12 to 15 wrestlers around the ring with cowboy hats on. And when the going gets tough, when the weasel decides to take a little walk, 10 to 15 wrestlers will bodily pick him up and throw him back in right here. I've been informed, as everybody knows, Hulk Hogan has been in Japan. We now know the incredible Hulk Hogan will not be here tonight. However, wait a minute. However, you're going to be surprised when you find out who the fifth man will be joining the High Flyers.
This eight. Man tag has been bedlam since the very beginning. Greg Gagne there with a boot to Ken Patera as he has an arm bar. I'm Jerry Blackwell. It's been all Gagne, Brunzell, Stevens, and Von Raschke so far. Baron Von Raschke in for the incredible Hulk Hogan in this match, not in the ring at the present time, I am quick to add. The Hulk still in Japan. This is Ray, the Crippler Stevens in against Jerry Blackwell, who tags off with Sheik Adnan L. Casey. And in actuality, Stevens pushed Blackwell over there so he could tag off with the Sheik. Stevens wants a piece of Casey's hide. And a lot more. And Casey refuses to come in. Blackwell has to continue. Casey still has that right wrist encased with, whether it is a full plaster of Paris cast or a heavy wrap device. Why, I don't know. He maintains that that right wrist is still not healed yet. And now Jerry Blackwell has Stevens in trouble. Jimmy Brunzell went over and took care of Sheik Adnan L. Casey as he was trying to make some noise. All the time, Blackwell in a headlock on Stevens. Stevens drives Blackwell across and into the ropes and in turn into Casey and Patera. Casey took the brunt of that. Gagne rips a right hand to the head of Blackwell, and now the Baron, the Clawmaster, is in against Jerry Blackwell with a headlock on him. The Clawmaster with the strongest hands in professional wrestling. He puts the claw hold on, and very, very few come out of it. Blackwell has been in there for some time. One thing about Jerry, with all that 472 pounds, he is rather quick to tire. A full house at the Civic Center in St. Paul, Minnesota. Watching this eight-man tag, Blackwell, Patera, Casey, and Saito. On one side, Gagne, Brunzell, Stevens, and Von Raschke on the other. And Von Raschke finds himself in trouble now. In the ring with Jerry Blackwell, strutting his stuff. We may see the splash here. We do. But the Baron gets out of the way in time and tags off with Greg Gagne. Gagne off that second rope. Down onto the stomach. Oh, that hurt. Gagne gone wild with lefts and rights. The whip. Oh, Greg had him all lined up for the flying drop kick. But Blackwell hung onto that top rope. And Greg took the force of the blow right on the back of his head. Now Mr. Saito goes to the second rope and down with the arm smash on the back of Greg Gagne. Mr. Saito, 247 pounds from Tokyo, Japan. Works the side of the neck of Greg Gagne. Now Sheik Adnan El Casey grabbing a hold of Gagne. Again, Mr. Saito in on Greg Gagne. A cover. Two count. Tag off. Ken Patera now in. Drives a boot to the midsection of Greg Gagne, who's taking quite a beating in there. And now a knee to the middle of the back of Gagne. Again, Patera working on the back of Greg Gagne. Tagging off. And in now is Adnan El Casey, driving that right hand to the midsection. And now clawing the back of Gagne. At the 10-minute mark of this one-fall 60-minute match, an eight-man tag. And Greg Gagne is really getting a workout. And now Brunzell can take it no longer, seeing his tag team partner taking all the punishment. Marty Miller is the referee, and a thankless job he has here against or with eight men in there. And many is the time all eight have been in at the same time. We have at least six of them in there now. Bear hug here by Casey on Gagne. Those are the two that are supposed to be in there. Greg Gagne has taken a tremendous amount of punishment the time he has been in. It's a longer stretch than what he wants to stay in. They like to tag off and work very, very quickly. Gagne trying to drive Casey across the ring. He gets one step. He gets two. And here is Jerry Blackwell moving in, but Miller intercepts. Brunzell comes in. Drives a forearm smash, and now Mr. Saito off the top rope. But referee Marty Miller did not see it. Miller was being detained elsewhere, and here's a falling elbow smash by Jerry Blackwell. Ray the Crippler Stevens comes in to save Greg Gagne from a pinfall here. Again, Blackwell trying to set up the helpless Greg Gagne. There is the body splash, 472 pounds down on top of Greg Gagne. Baron von Raschke comes in, and Gagne is saved one more time. Blackwell picking up Gagne, driving him down on the leg, the back on the leg, the quadricep muscles of Ken Patera. Gagne helpless on the side. And the crowd is chanting. Gagne fighting back on Ken Patera. Patera picks him up and gets him into that bear hug. Ken Patera, one of the strongest men in the world. Oh, Gagne has taken a lot of punishment, and he can't make his way to the corner to tag off. There have been two and three tags on the other side, and Gagne has been in all alone over this stretch and period of time. Patera with tremendous strength, putting tremendous pressure on the lower back of Greg Gagne. Gagne firing back with right hands. Patera is down. He is covered by Gagne. A two count. Patera rolls Gagne over and gets a two count. As von Raschke, Stevens, and Brunzell look on, almost helpless to help Greg Gagne. However, if he gets in deep, deep trouble, you can bet your boots that they'll come in. A tag off here. Mr. Saito. Again, Gagne cannot make his way to the corner. And Saito picks up where Patera left off, working on the back. Could this be the scorpion leg lock? Mr. Saito trying to turn Gagne over. In comes Brunzell with a forearm smash. Mr. Saito trying to go to work on Brunzell. And Mr. Saito gets a pair of 10 and a halfs to the head, and Gagne has tagged off to Jim Brunzell. Forearm smash after forearm smash. And here is the drop kick by Brunzell that caught Mr. Saito flush. The snapmare. Step over, toe hold. Indian deathlock. But here is the elbow smash by Ken Patera, and that hold is broken. Patera continues to work on Brunzell.
We're at 15 minutes.
The 15-minute mark. Here is Ray the Crippler Stevens entering the picture. And now Brunzell finds himself in a peck of trouble in a foreign corner, crawling between the legs of Casey, between the legs of Blackwell, and tagging off with the Clawmaster, Baron von Raschke. And he has, is it? Yes, it is. Sheik Adnan El Casey takes the body drop. The Baron firing away on Blackwell, and now the claw on Sheik Adnan El Casey. Jumping, Jimmy Brunzell enters, Greg Gagne enters. Blackwell is coming in. Von Raschke drops the claw hold on Casey and goes to work on Blackwell. Look at that flying maneuver. A cover here and a three count. Baron von Raschke has been pinned by a combination of Jim Brunzell and Greg Gagne. It is Greg Gagne now firing Ken Patera out of the ring. A very, very much planned maneuver with Gagne and Brunzell outside the ring. Stevens and the Baron von Raschke inside. Stevens and the Baron going to the ropes and vaulting the other two, Brunzell and Gagne, into the ring onto the fallen Sheik Adnan El Casey, and the pinfall and victory for Gagne, Brunzell, Stevens, and von Raschke at 15:03. Wrestler who made Milwaukee famous, the Crusher, seconding Mad Dog Vachon. This one is now officially underway, but it started a couple of moments ago, and immediately Nick Bockwinkel to the attack, working over Mad Dog Vachon here in the opening minute, and almost bringing this match to a very, very quick end. Here's a choke by Nick Bockwinkel, who has said he will use any and every means and device at his command in this one against Mad Dog Vachon. And he certainly is starting out that way. Vachon stunned by the quick opening. of the heavyweight champion. VACHON himself, a former heavyweight champion of the world. Bockwinkel firing away to the head of Mad Dog VACHON. The dog is hurt. There's no two ways about it. Here at the immediate outset of this match, Jim Mitchell, the referee. VACHON has not had a chance whatsoever to get going, and Nick Bockwinkel uses the ropes to work on the neck of Mad Dog, who reels backwards across the ring and takes a knee to the midsection, and a snap mare and a cover by Bockwinkel. Bockwinkel working on the neck. Jim Mitchell telling him to break the hold. Bockwinkel knowing that he has the dog in trouble. VACHON starting to come out of it now. That's his first offensive move of the match. And powerful shoulder blocks to the midsection of the champion. And there you have the left hand again to the throat of Nick Bockwinkel a third time. And Mad Dog VACHON has come alive. He has his hand inside the cheek of Nick Bockwinkel, and he has just about ripped it apart. VACHON looking over in the direction of Bobby Heenan, who is nowhere in sight right now. There you see the Crusher coming up to the ring apron just in case he is needed. He has vowed to keep law and order. He has told Bobby Heenan, you better not blink your eyes, fella, because I'm going to be on you like a bad habit. And again, Mad Dog VACHON with his hand inside the cheek of Nick Bockwinkel and stretching that cheek to the maximum and then some. And suddenly it is all Mad Dog VACHON as he has the champion in a bad way and rips those boots to the midsection. And the crowd chants. Bobby Heenan, you see him with a very, very distressed look on his face as his man is in deep trouble and is tossed out of the ring, and Mad Dog VACHON comes after him. VACHON now with the microphone right into the middle of the back of Nick Bockwinkel. VACHON is back in, Bockwinkel is not. Bobby Heenan trying to come to the aid of his champion, and the Crusher walks him off. Mad Dog VACHON has to get back inside that ring before he is disqualified, and he does, as Mitchell was counting on him. VACHON has really gone to work on Nick Bockwinkel, and the Crusher is doing exactly what he said he would. Keep Bobby Heenan away from Nick Bockwinkel. So far, that is. And, oh, wow! Mad Dog VACHON uses that top rope to just about snap the neck of Bockwinkel. He's back in. Bockwinkel takes a body slam, a cover by Mad Dog VACHON. But you see the leg, the left leg. And Mad Dog VACHON is biting that left leg of Nick Bockwinkel. That left leg was draped over the lower rope strand, and thus Jimmy Mitchell stopped the count at two. VACHON will do whatever he has to win this match, and Bockwinkel has said that he will do the same. Clawing away at the leg. Bockwinkel knows he is in the ring with something other than the conventional wrestler, that's for sure. VACHON now using the second rope strand as he drapes the leg of Nick Bockwinkel over that rope strand, trying to tie it up maybe with the bottom one, too. And you see Bobby Heenan running around the ring and being chased by the Crusher. The Crusher with that trademark cigar in his mouth wherever he goes. And now Nick Bockwinkel outside the ring, doesn't know which direction he is headed. He sees the Crusher and bids a hasty retreat. For one of the very, very few times in this match, Bobby Heenan is able to talk to and work with his champion, but not for long. The Dog brings Bockwinkel in a very unconventional way. A left hand to the throat of Bockwinkel by Mad Dog Vachon. Oh, he wants that championship and wants it badly. The whip, the back body drop, the cover. Somehow, from somewhere, as champions always do, they find that bit of reserve to suddenly come back from the depths. Right when it seems they are beaten, they find something extra. And Nick Bockwinkel did it there. You saw Vern Gagne do it for year after year after year in tough situations. Bockwinkel is doing the same thing, despite the fact he is in deep, deep, deep trouble. Aside from the opening minute and a half to 2 minutes of this match, when it was all Bockwinkel, it has since been all Mad Dog Vachon. Vachon again to the biting technique. Bockwinkel gets out of the way, and Vachon may be hurt, as Vachon came charging from across the ring to put a shoulder block into Bockwinkel. Nick saw it coming, got out of the way, and Vachon went just about, I believe, all the way to the ring post. Bockwinkel trying to call upon more of the reserve, which he has. Now knowing he has the Dog in trouble, trying to set up the pile driver. Mad Dog Vachon trying to fight his way clear. Bockwinkel can't get it on him yet. And now it's reversed and over goes the champion. The Dog comes back. And again, he drapes Bockwinkel's neck over that second rope. Here comes Vachon from across the ring. Oh, that's gotta hurt. We may see a new champion here tonight. A cover here by the Dog and a count of two. Did Mad Dog lift Bockwinkel's head up and shoulder up when it looked like he had him beaten? I think he did. And now, oh, the pile driver for Mad Dog Vachon, a count of two. Wait a minute, let's see. Was it three? Was it three? Did Mad Dog Vachon get the pinfall here? Jim Mitchell is raising his hand and says yes. Yes, he did. Mad Dog Vachon has pinned Nick Bockwinkel and has taken the heavyweight championship of the world away from him. But Bobby Heenan and Nick Bockwinkel are not taking this lying down. They're both going to work now on the Crusher and on Mad Dog Vachon. The Crusher is all alone against Bobby Heenan and Nick Bockwinkel. A chair has been thrown in. Bockwinkel goes after the Crusher with the chair. The Crusher gets out of the way, and now he has the chair. He is in control, and he and Heenan are there alone, and Heenan takes it. Bockwinkel takes it. Again, Heenan gets the chair from the Crusher. The Crusher again winding up with that chair, aiming it for Nick Bockwinkel. He gets him. The Dog has come to, and he throws Bobby Heenan over the top rip, over the top rope, and out of the ring. And the battle royal goes on. But Mad Dog Vachon has taken the heavyweight championship from Nick Bockwinkel, despite the fact what you see going on here and now. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Now they're saying that Bockwinkel has been disqualified. And if indeed that is the case, then the championship remains with Nick Bockwinkel. They are announcing that Bockwinkel has been disqualified, and indeed Mad Dog Vachon has won the match, but Bockwinkel remains the heavyweight champion. Both Mad Dog Vachon and the Crusher working on Bockwinkel. Where is Bobby Heenan in all of this? He is nowhere in sight. He is not to be found to help his champion. There you see Jim Mitchell, the referee, raising the hands of both Mad Dog Vachon and the Crusher in victory. But as you heard Gene Okerlund, the ring announcer, announce after conferring with Mitchell that Bockwinkel was disqualified. but he keeps the championship belt. Oh, a tough break for Mad Dog Vachon. And, of course, the Crusher, but particularly for Vachon, who wanted that championship so very, very badly. He got the victory, but he wanted more than that. He wanted the championship belt, too. And if the rules of the game apply here, as I believe they certainly do, the championship stays with Bockwinkel. Let's see if there are further announcements coming from Gene Okerlund at ringside. Mad Dog Vachon is climbing back into the ring. He has the championship belt. Vachon is carrying the championship belt. Bockwinkel was disqualified for coming off the top rope. The Dog is leaving the ring with the championship belt.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, again, tremendous controversy here at the Civic Center. I have-